Welcome to the CTO Demon channel. Well, finally, we've come to the real core curriculum of the channel. And today is the first really technical teaching. And the topic we have in front of us is Antegrade wire escalation. Now, this is not going to be a long, exhaustive teaching on all the Antegrade wiring techniques there is. Rather, what this is over the years, I've proctored many CTO operators, and many times you see where they get stuck. And you say, if only they did this, they wouldn't get stuck. If only they did this, trouble wouldn't happen. So it's really a collection of really things that are most useful when I'm proctoring somebody. If they listen to this advice, they make the most progress in their Antegrade wire escalation. Now, first concept we need to understand in Antegrade wire escalation is anatomy dictates strategy. And that's a very important concept for all CTO PCI, but particularly for Antegrade wire escalation. Now, we've published in the APCTO Club wiring paper in heart-lung circulation, see link in description below, the technique of looking at the proximal cap and choosing the wire. If you have a tapered proximal cap with a residual channel, use an XTR. If you have a tapered proximal cap, then without a channel, then XTA. If you have a blunt stump, then a Gaia second or Gaia next two wire. However, as we do more CTO, we begin to recognize other types of proximal cap that are more problematic. And one particular group of proximal cap is the rounded blunt stump proximal cap, often with some calcification. Now, there are two variants of this proximal cap. One is with a nearby side branch, the other is without. And this kind of blunted, rounded proximal cap causes a lot of problems and wastes a lot of time for many operators, because they're often very hard, and many of them actually require a Conquest 12 gram or Convienza Pro 12 gram wire to puncture. So we should consider using this technique, using a high penetration force wire to penetrate. Now, if there is a side branch, the recommended technique is to use IVUS to locate the proximal cap, and then use a dual lumen catheter to support your high penetration force wire, and then penetrate into the cap. If there's no proximal side branch, what we should do is use coaxial anchor or power anchor. What a power anchor is you put a balloon that's more or less the same size as the proximal vessel in the proximal vessel. Underneath the balloon, you put a microcatheter, and you inflate the balloon to 8 or 10 atmospheres to anchor the microcatheter. This produces a very strong coaxial backup force. And then you use a Conquest 12 gram wire to puncture into the cap. Well, some of you will say, well, isn't that quite dangerous to do this puncture? Well, it's not if you do it correctly and safely. So there are two principles to allow safe and correct puncture of the proximal cap. First, is that you should use good backup force. The wire becomes dangerous when you don't have good enough backup force and the wire floats around. So you should use a dual lumen catheter or a coaxial anchor. The second is you shouldn't puncture very far. You should aim to really use the high penetration force wire just to puncture the cap, 1, 2, or at most 3 millimeters into the cap, and then you take the wire out and you put in an intermediate penetration force wire, a pilot if you like, or UB3 or a Gladys ES, something like that, into the hole and wire further down. This technique I think should be taught to all CTO operators because it increases the number of CTOs you can do quite dramatically. Now, every CTO operators operate in a different part of the world and they have a different cohort of CTO patients. So you need to know your own cohort. You need to know what percentage of those rounded blunt stumps that you see require Conquest 12. And if you do some CTOs, very soon you're going to get a quick idea of what percentage are the patients in your practice that requires a high penetration force wire. Now, in my own practice, if I see a blunt rounded cap, I've calculated it from our registry, about 40% of those patients actually in the end require a Conquest 12. And so nowadays, I will try to look at the cap and see if there are any features that suggest this is going to be hard, and probably move to a Conquest 12 in about half the cases straight off the bat. And this saves a lot of time. It saves a lot of time of poking with a guy second. The reason is, actually, you say poking with a guy second is safe, but it isn't. Because if you're not poking into the cap, you can actually flip the guy second down the side branch, and it can just as easily perforate the side branch or dissect the side branch and cause a problem. So if we do a Conquest 12 gram puncture well, with good backup force, and penetrate only a little bit and then step down, it's actually a very safe procedure. And it should be something that proctors teach every CTO operator early on in their proctorship. Now, after we penetrate the proximal cap and we step down to a Gladys ES or something, and we get down somewhere down the vessel, the next step is to try to push the microcatheter into the proximal cap. Now, either it goes or it doesn't. And usually, if you require 12 gram wire to puncture the proximal cap, the microcatheter is not going to go. So the next debate is whether we should break the proximal cap with a small balloon or not. Now, some older generation operators hate to break the proximal cap because of the risk of dissection and hematoma expansion into the CTO body. However, I think today, with the technology we have, with the use of guide extension catheters to control the inflow to the CTO, with the use of microcatheters, if we have an ipsilateral collateral, we can put a microcatheter down there to inject selectively and light up and opacify the distal vessel. With these techniques, we now almost don't need to do injections from the guiding once we've dilated the proximal cap. And so we've mitigated the risk of breaking the proximal cap. And so in my practice, I always go for breaking the proximal cap, because breaking the proximal cap allows better wire control. It's safer when we have better wire control inside the CTO body. And the risk can be mitigated with guide extension catheter and selective microcatheter injection of ipsilateral collateral if needed. So break the proximal cap. Now, when we are wiring through the CTO body, a lot of operators run into trouble. And that's because they don't understand the paradox between normal wiring and CTO vessel wiring. When we're doing normal PCI, if a wire meets resistance, what do? We pull it back a little bit and we redirect it in the opposite direction and it will go. Now that is correct, because when we're wiring an open vessel, when we meet resistance, we're either hitting against a plaque or we're hitting against a side branch, and we need to move out of the side branch or the plaque to get the true lumen. But in the CTO, when we meet resistance, we are in the plaque, because there's only three places in a CTO where there's no resistance. Number one, the subinduminal space. Subinduminal space is very smooth, no resistance there. Number two, the pericardium. Pericardium is very smooth, no resistance there. And number three, the distal true lumen. If it's a normal distal true lumen, there's no resistance there. But it's unlikely, while we're crossing the CTO body, that we're in the distal true lumen already. So if during wiring the CTO body, our wire is very smooth, it's in the wrong place. But if it's meeting resistance, it's actually in the right place, because plaque generates resistance. So if we're doing CTO wiring and we meet resistance, we should not redirect the wire, because our wire tip's in the right place. If we redirect it, it's going to be in the wrong place. Instead, what we should do is to push the microcatheter forward to increase the penetration force of the wire to penetrate the hard plaque. And if that doesn't work, we should step up. We should step up to a guy two or guy three to penetrate the plaque, because resistance means the correct place. So this is the paradox. In normal PCI wiring, resistance means wrong place. But in CTO PCI wiring, resistance means right place. So instead of, I should redirect when I'm stuck, we should go for we should penetrate when we're stuck. That's the first paradox. The second paradox is when we're wiring a normal PCI case with an open vessel, if the wire is going very well, we keep going and we don't have to look because we know it's in the right place because a normal open vessel wires very easily. This is the opposite in CTO PCI. When the wire is going very well, it's either in the subminimal space or it's in the pericardium or it's in the distal true lumen. All three positions need to be confirmed. We can't keep going without confirmation. So we should check when it's going very freely. Unlike normal PCI, we should not check when we're going very freely. Okay? The third paradox is when the wire is going very well in normal PCI, we keep going with the wire. But this should not be the case for CTO PCI. The reason is your wire is actually a plaque detector. The tip of your wire allows you to feel resistance, and feeling resistance tells you you're in the plaque. You don't want to use a wire that's so high in penetration force that it goes through the plaque like a knife through butter, because then you won't know whether you're in the plaque or not. So let's say you wire down a vessel and you met some resistance with your XTA. You push the micrograph forward and you can't penetrate. You step up to a guy next to and you manage to penetrate the resistance and the wire's going, but you're still a long way from the distal cap. The guy next to goes very easily and you don't feel any resistance. Now, instead of wiring on, which is what you would do if it was an open vessel, a normal PCI, you should step back down. You should go back to guy next one or XTA so that you can continue to feel resistance to make sure you can detect your implant. So knowing these three paradoxes, the three opposite ways of doing things between normal PCI and CTO PCI is very helpful in crossing the CTO body. Now the final part and the most difficult part of antegrade wire escalation is actually penetrating the distal cap into the distal true lumen. Actually, for most operators, they will find this. It's actually relatively easy most of the time to get through the proximal cap and get to the distal cap. But getting from the distal cap into the distal true lumen, that's really difficult. And here, once again, our motto of anatomy dictates strategy is very important. And in the heart-lung circulation AP steel wiring paper, we state very clearly the types of morphology of distal cap that predicts the distal cap is going to be tough to puncture. And if we see these types of morphology, we should recognize it and not carry on with a low or even an intermediate penetration force wire. Because if we try to penetrate a tough cap with an inadequate penetration force wire, it's going to slip off the cap and cause a hematoma distal, cause an expansion of subminimal space distal to the distal cap, making further penetration of the distal cap very difficult. The morphologies in the paper are Washington monument morphology. That's the kind of cap that's got this very sharp tip. Those are usually fairly hard. The rounded distal cap, those are very hard. The distal cap with visible calcium, and the distal cap with large side branch next to the cap. Those four morphology caps are usually hard. And in my practice, often I will even step up to a Conquest 12 gram straight away once I get near to this type of morphology in distal cap. And you say to me, well, CTO Demon, isn't it very dangerous to step up to a Conquest 12? Well, it's not, because Conquest 12 is only dangerous when either it's not controlled or we don't know where it's going. But by the time your wires get near to a distal cap, and if you have good distal cap opacification, then the distance between your wire and the distal cap is very short. There's very little distance for your high penetration force wire to go outside the vessel. And so in this very clearly delineated path of very short distance, high penetration force wire is actually relatively safe. Now, it may be unsafe when you have penetrated distal cap to wire a very diffuse distal vessel with a high penetration force wire. And of course, you can step down after you penetrate into the distal true lumen. But penetrating the distal true lumen is actually fairly safe if your CTO wire is already very near the distal cap. So if you see these four morphology, you should consider stepping up. to a guy next three or to a conquest wire to penetrate the distal cap. Now, the one other piece of very important information is often I see operators, they wire and the wire is already next to the distal cap. And then they try to redirect that wire to penetrate. We've got to understand that wire are forward penetrating devices, which means they produce the best penetration force to something that's ahead of the wire. You will see when you watch the Japanese Antegrade masters at work, they don't wire until the wire reaches the distal cap and then do an injection to see where it is. No, they start doing injections when the wire is about 15 millimeters away from the distal cap. The reason is they understand that 15 millimeters away from the distal cap is when you've got to start redirecting that wire to point at the distal cap, because the wire takes distance to realign itself towards the distal cap. Now, of course, the best way to wire a distal cap is to use the 3D fluoroscopic method, which Dr. Okamura published in his paper. Unfortunately, that paper is very difficult to understand. It puts wires in eight different positions, and each position's in eight different directions. And so you have 64 possible directions and positions of the wire, and you've got to remember these to wire. And it's very difficult for people to understand. I found it much easier actually to use our imaginations to understand 3D fluoroscopic wiring. But that of course is a very long video again, and I'm not going to put it here. And I'll probably record another video talking about 3D fluoroscopic wiring of the distal cap especially, and that's for another video. But I hope with this information on Antegrade wire escalation, you have more success and you overcome a lot of the places where people get stuck with Antegrade wire escalation. This, of course, is a core curriculum video, so I hope our APCTO fellows and friends who come to train with me, especially those, will take a look at this video. If you like the video, do subscribe so that you get new videos online, and I hope to cover the 3D wiring next time. Bye-bye.